Hello and welcome to another edition of the Somerville Media Center, Somerville Journal News Roundup. I'm happy to be joined with Julia Taliesin from the Somerville Journal.
So yes, so Somerville, I mean, like much of Mass, there's been an increase in cases. Somerville is still doing pretty good. If you go on the Somerville website, to somervillema.gov/COVID-19, they have kind of a button that you can click on to view dashboard, and that data dashboard, they kind of have a simple breakdown of cases on the main page, but if you go to the dashboard, they have kind of a more complex breakdown. They have kind of like maps and visualizations, so you can see kind of that kind of initial spike and versus kind of where we are now. So in terms of numbers, we are today, I believe this data was updated on November 10th. We are recording on November 11th. So the total number of confirmed positive cases has surpassed 1,500. So we're at 1,589. The total probable positive cases at the moment is 123. Over 1,400 have recovered at 1,437. And right now, sadly, there have been 47 confirmed fatalities. We are approaching 50. See that like initial spike that we all experienced in the spring. You can see how, you know, Somerville did a pretty good job of bringing it down in the summer. And you can see though, you know, of course that cases have increased a bit since then, but that it hasn't gotten to the level that it was at, which is a really good thing. You can see the daily active cases. So how many cases we have active at the moment. The cumulative number of recovered and positive cases, that obviously goes up because that's just the total number. If you scroll down just a little more, exactly the positive cases by month, that's kind of an even more direct visualization of just where we're at. So like you can see in April, we had 540 cases. In October, we had 164. So Somerville is still doing a pretty good job. But this is really helpful. I think it's really important for all of us to kind of look at things like this to continue educating ourselves about like how we should be protecting ourselves, the importance of getting tested, of still wearing masks. But I actually, I think if you scroll up just a little bit, I think you're kind of looking at that heat map as well. So I look at this data regularly, just, you know, to stay educated because I, you know, live in this community, but also because I'm interested in the stories that the data is telling. So if you kind of look at that heat map and the graph above, which is by zip code, you can actually see a pattern a little bit that the 02145 zip code has had a much higher spike in the spring.
Yeah.
And even since then has had a little bit of a higher case rate, which when you go down to our beautiful little visualization of the Somerville in the heat map, you can see is pretty concentrated in that kind of East Somerville area. So I was interested by this, and Somerville has a really great data team. So I kind of got in touch with them and wanted to look at a couple factors because I obviously know, you know, it's pretty, you know, a lot of people know if you live in the city that East Somerville is one of the, you know, lower income areas of the city. It's a much more diverse area of the city. But there are also other factors, like there's more elderly housing in that area of the city. You know, there's other things to think about.
Yeah.
So I think, you know, when I was looking at this, I really like wanted to get a sense of, you know, what was going on. So there's the zip code, but there's also like, what people do for a living. There's race and ethnicity. There's, age of people. So I kind of took a look at all sorts of different things like that. And I think, you know, it's pretty clear, that, you know, it has, like I was speaking with one of Somerville's data analysts, and when you look at the data, there's also pretty clearly a higher incidence of COVID among those of Hispanic and Latino ethnicity, which you can actually see also if you continue scrolling down. I know you've gotten off it on that COVID dashboard, which you can see there's like a rate, yes, exactly. If you keep on scrolling a little bit, right there. So the rate of cases per 100,000 by Hispanic origin, you can see that it's about four times the number. So this is absolutely related to that heat map. So that's the kind of thing that I was looking into, but it's also, it's related to median income. You know, the median income in the OT145 is about 75,000 versus the median income in like OT144, which is more like 108. When you look at the amount of people who are on food assistance or SNAP, et cetera, the OT145 is about 11.2% versus the OT144, which is 7.8%. You know what I mean? So there's a lot of factors, but I spoke with counselors Matt McLaughlin and Jesse Klingen, who are Ward 1 and Ward 4, Welcome Project Executive Director Ben Echevarria, and they all really spoke to all of this, and what they're seeing on the ground and kind of what they're hearing from their constituents is that this is absolutely a product of income. It's a product of ethnicity, but it's a product of just the fact that many of the people living in these neighborhoods haven't had the luxury of working from home, they're still taking public transportation. And, you know, they're also, this is an area, a very dense area of Somerville, which is the densest city in New England. So already, you have more people living in apartments, more people living in intergenerational housing. So I think this is, just really important for us to keep an eye on, because inequity is showing itself even in Somerville. And that's not necessarily, a bad thing. It's showing itself across the country. It's just that we can continue to learn from it. When I was speaking with Somerville Health Director Doug Kress, he was definitely emphasizing the important work that, their teams have been doing around food assistance, getting groceries to people, supporting people who need to quarantine, but also just working with people who speak the language, working to have kind of ambassadors in the community who can get the word out about wearing masks, about quarantining, about kind of safety if you do have to take a bus to work. And he was really driving home, which I think is important to bring up again, that everyone needs to get their flu shot. He was like, please, please mention this. I know it's not directly related, but the symptoms are so similar, and of course it's important to keep wearing a mask, and of course it's important to wash your hands and do all the things that we've been told to do for months. But as we're heading into this winter season, and as when you look at those maps, you can see kind of cases are climbing a little bit. It's going to be really important, just so we don't overwhelm healthcare facilities with possible cases of COVID, for people to get their flu vaccine. So I've already done it. If it's safe for you, please do it. And that's another thing he pointed out, that for a number of reasons, not everyone can get the flu vaccine, whether it's allergies, or certain religious preferences, whatever it may be, and that it's on those of us who can to protect those people as well.
That's a good point. Yeah. And you don't often hear that point made, that, that just more people who are vaccinated, mm-hmm. they are protecting the ones that aren't able to. Yeah. We should also mention that there's a mask advisory and a stay-at-home advisory that's been put in place throughout the Commonwealth. Mm-hmm. Basically, if you're out of doors, definitely if you're indoors, but if you're outdoors, you need to be wearing a mask even when you're not near another person. And that there is, they're not exactly calling it a curfew, they're calling it a stay-at-home advisory between 10 p.m. and 5 a.m. Mm-hmm. If you don't have to be out, if you're not working, stay home. And restaurants have been told to close at 9:30, but to not take any more food orders at 9:30. And so there's things put in place for the restaurant industry, mm-hmm. which, they're struggling. And so this is not helping. But, in the middle of a health emergency, as cases are going up, it's necessary. So, yes, if you leave your house, wear a mask.
Yeah, I think, that's a really good point. Thank you for bringing that up. It's something for all of us to keep in mind, even though it's not necessarily a local order. Somerville, of course, has been very supportive of that. They've been pretty supportive of any protective measures for our citizens. But that is something else that's been on my mind a lot, kind of speaking about restaurants, that, there was some news the other day, more national news, about a possible vaccine. There were some vaccines that had some pretty good success rates. If you're someone who's keeping on top of that, you might have, been hopeful or been excited about something like that. But I think it's really important to keep in mind that even if a vaccine turns up tomorrow that is 100% effective. It's going to take time. You know, it's going to take time for this to roll out. And I think it's really important for all of us to not quite, we can't relax. And even once a vaccine, turns up, it still won't quite be time. We need to continue paying attention to our public health officials. They have been, you know, especially in Somerville, they've been leading us right. Somerville has had, you know, pretty good success with this, all things considered. So all of the guidance that we all know by now, you know what I mean? It's not different.
Right.
We should really try to continue following as much as we can. And especially heading into the holidays, this is something that's been on my mind. You know, if I'm going to celebrate in any way in the presence of my family, I need to start thinking about getting tested now so that I can protect my family and I can protect my grandparents, even if I'm not going to be, you know, all over them and like cooking with them necessarily, even I'm just going to be with them eating with the mask off, whatever that might be outside, you know what I mean?
Yeah.
In the cold, that we need to continue strategizing around that, because it's this time of year, we're all exhausted. We just want to eat some freaking turkey and like just relax, you know what I mean? But it's not, the virus isn't done with us.
Yeah.
And you know, we're, you know, as they predicted, there was a fall surge. There's going to be a winter surge. It might be made worse by the flu. This is not over. And I hate having to say this. I would awfully like it to be. But I know I sound like I'm hounding, but I think it's so important to keep thinking about this and also to keep thinking about our small stores and shopping local and eating local and, you know, supporting places like the Armory Cafe and getting takeout from restaurants before they close. You know, just really trying to support our communities through this, because it's not over and we have to keep doing what we've been doing.
Absolutely. So, yeah. Absolutely. Yeah. Yeah. The holidays are definitely going to be different this year, and everybody's going to decide among their families, you know, how they want to do it. But however you do it, it needs to be done responsibly. So yeah, just stay responsible, please.
Heck yeah.
Moving on to the other big news item is the election results.
Yeah,
we're talking on the 11th, and election day was a little over a week ago. How did Somerville fare with the election results?
Yeah, so thankfully, I mean, Somerville knew pretty quickly. They posted unofficial results, I think at like 9:30 on election night. The official results always come out. I think they'll be out probably next week. But the unofficial results are pretty reliable and always have been. So Somerville wasn't a big surprise. Somerville pretty decidedly elected Joe Biden and Kamala Harris, the election has since been called for them. That we on election day did not know what was going on. I think it's interesting. You and I were thinking about doing an election roundup last week, and we wouldn't have known then if we had what was going on with the national election. So in Somerville, Biden and Harris got 87.3% of the vote. Biden Harris also decidedly won Massachusetts. Trump Pence got 10.2% of the vote. And there was like 0.02% of the vote was split between the Green Rainbow and Libertarian candidates that were on the ballot. As far as Senator goes, again, Somerville went blue. About 87.6% voted for Ed Markey for Senator in Congress. He was also declared the winner. Kevin O'Connor, the Republican candidate, got 10.6% of the vote. Ayanna Pressley did not have a Republican challenger, but she did have an independent challenger. So she got 85.1% of the vote. This is all, if you recognize in a pattern, you would be correct. And her opponent, Roy Owens, got about 10.5%. So all of this kind of seemed to fall on party lines. Those were the main contested races. State Representative Mike Connolly, Christine Barber, Senator Pat Jalin, Erica Eiderhoven, who had a primary challenger, but was running unopposed on the ballot, who is taking Denise Provost's place in January. They were all running unopposed and were reelected. And there were also Terrence Kennedy on the Governor's Council and Register of Probate Tara DeCristoforo were also on the ballot, running unopposed, all were reelected. And then we had a few questions.
Right.
So the first question, right to repair, passed in Massachusetts. Somerville did vote to pass that by a slightly lower margin. So that was 76.5% voted to approve that. So voted yes. And that was declared the winner, and 18.5% voted no. Interestingly, Somerville overwhelmingly voted to adopt ranked choice voting, but that question did not pass in Massachusetts. So that's kind of a distinction there. So 72.7% of voters in Somerville wanted ranked choice voting, and 23.3% did not. And the no is what was declared the winner. So the ranked choice voting campaign eventually conceded that pretty quickly the next day. And I think those were all of the binding things. There were also, I think, a couple non-binding questions on the ballot. Question three, which asked whether representatives should vote in favor of transitioning to 100% renewable energy in the next two decades. And question four, which asked about whether representatives should vote to make House committee votes public. And both of those were overwhelmingly supported by voters, but neither one of them is binding. So we'll just have to see what happens.
So if I didn't see, because I didn't see those non-binding questions on my ballot, so did some
interesting. So yeah. they weren't on every ballot. I for example, I am a voter in North Cambridge and I only voted on question three. So I think it depended on who your representative was and whether like whether or not they elected to have that question on the ballot. So yeah, so that was not across the board, not every Somerville voter, that was only in certain wards and districts.
Okay.
That those would show up. So that's kind of like the breakdown itself. But what I was really interested in was voter turnout, which is everyone's kind of had their eye on, right? Especially since Joe Biden was like declared, right, like winning by like the most votes ever or whatever, something like that. So Somerville has historically had pretty high voter turnout in these presidential and state elections. So in this one, there was a 69.7% voter turnout.
Wow.
So of Somerville's 58,173 voters, 40,541 cast a ballot, which is pretty significant. And this is relatively comparable to the state turnout, which was a little bit higher. But many also, you know, kind of, I think it was just over 70. But interestingly, Somerville's voter turnout this year was not higher than the 2016 voter turnout. So the 2016 really? Voter turnout was 75.2%.
Oh, that's interesting.
It is, yeah.
Is there anything that people are pointing to?
Not that I've seen yet. I mean, of course, there's different reasons. You know, for example, there are now more voters in Somerville. So interestingly, in 2016, 40,874 ballots were cast. And in 2020, 40,541 ballots were cast. That's a difference of less than 300 votes, right? So, or around 300 votes. And however, in 2016, there were 54,300 voters, and there have since been about 4,000 more voters registered. So the percents have kind of changed, even though almost the same number of ballots were cast. So I'm not entirely sure. I mean, it's pointing at age. I don't have kind of more data breakdown, which I would love to get working with the Somerville Election Commission on like the ages of people that voted, how that changed, what was the voter turnout by age in Somerville. Those are all things that I would love to look into. I don't have that data right now. But also interestingly, Somerville definitely like voted by, like a lot of Somerville residents voted by mail. So I think of the 40,000 votes, 40,500 votes cast, almost 23,000 were by mail. So that's like over half. And almost 10,000, so about 9,000 were early votes. So the vast majority of Somerville residents had already voted before Election Day happened, which made a lot of sense because when I was out on Election Day, it was pretty darn quiet in most areas of the city.
That makes sense. Yeah, the word was out to vote by mail as soon as you can, you know, to just drop it in those ballot boxes as soon as you were able to. And yeah just kudos to the Somerville Election Commission and election commissions, you know, across the state, across the country, and all the hard work that those people have done and are continuing to do, because, you know, there's still final tallies to be,
yes,
to be reckoned with, which they're doing. So yeah, just a great job by everybody on that.
Absolutely. Yeah. Yeah. So I think that's the main breakdown, but yeah, it'll be interesting to kind of see. I love looking at data like this. I think it's really interesting.
You love data.
I do.
Awesome. So we have about 8 minutes left, and I know you wanted to talk about the Brady list and some work that you're doing around that. Can you let us know what's going on with that?
Yes. So I think this is just part of my kind of continued desire to report on policing in Somerville. It's pretty clear that residents are interested in what's going on, especially with all of the action that happened over the summer around abolishing the police, defunding the police, and just taking a kind of closer look at the police budget and police hiring, police practices, like the union negotiations. There's just a kind of heightened interest around a lot of this stuff. So the Brady list is not a Somerville specific tool. It is a county tool. So it's something that is kept by the Middlesex DA, Marion Ryan in our case. So she has a list of officers who have discovery notices against them. And what this essentially means is that this list of officers, which is not just Somerville, it's, you know, any of the cities and towns in the county, are officers who, when they've been called to, like as a witness in a case that she is prosecuting, have had to have some sort of notice issued about their conduct. It may be an infraction that they've had. It may be them falsifying a record, falsifying a police report, lying. It may be a disciplinary infraction. It could be any number of things. Sometimes it can be used to impeach them as a witness, so to significantly undermine their credibility. And sometimes it's not. Sometimes it's just something that the prosecution needs to notify the defense about. But I think the reason why I was interested in looking into this, and the reason why there is interest in this, is that the Brady list kind of is more kind of casually spoken about as like a list of bad actors. And as much as that can be true, that is not necessarily true, because these notices are issued for a wide range of infractions, some of which are older, some of which, you know, aren't necessarily directly related to the officers, like, you know, physical misconduct. There's a lot of different kind of ways, things that these can be issued for. So I wanted to just look at it a little bit deeper and talk to DA Ryan about like why she keeps this list. So to kind of get into this a bit, DA Ryan is one of the only DAs in Massachusetts to keep a public list. And to her, it's really important, because she said that it's important to her that their prosecutions are unassailable. So the kind of responsibility of the DA in this regard is to simply notify the defense if one of their witnesses has done something that could possibly impact the outcome of the case. This does not always get brought up in trial. Often it's just spoken about with the judge, and it's kind of decided whether or not it's relevant. And then it will go to trial after that. But she said that like the kind of the way it looks is like the DA's office starts a case. They'll know that certain officers are potential witnesses. They look at those witnesses, they run them against their Brady list. And if there's any crossover, then that notice gets sent to the defense attorney. And they're always checking it, because sometimes the reason a Brady notice was issued is just may have resolved, or something else may have come up. If that officer was not on the Brady list when the case started, maybe they were put on it by the time the case goes to trial. So she said this is kind of like a constant process.
That's fascinating to know, because it sounds like a system of internal checks and balances, you know, just making sure that you're
absolutely,
you know, like anybody working in the legal system would want, you know, to make sure that you have, you know, witnesses that are reliable. Mm-hmm. So that's fascinating to know that exists here in Massachusetts.
It's yes.
News to me.
Yeah. Yeah, absolutely. So I won't go too much into it, because like you said, we don't have a ton of time, but kind of just to get a little more Somerville specific, today there are on the overall list, which she provided to me, which is from 2013 through February of 2020, there are, I think, 117 officers on the list. 12 of those are from Somerville, but 9 of them have since retired or left the force. So there are only 3 officers currently in Somerville who have a Brady letter in their file. And I've you know, named them. We have a story up, which you are welcome to look into. And one of those officers also was the subject of some controversy a month ago, Officer Michael McGrath, when he was placed on unpaid leave after the DA announced, he was officially charged with a felony by the DA after an investigation concerning allegations of excessive force that happened during an arrest. There was some video that was released of this. So he is technically still an officer in Somerville, but he is now on unpaid leave. So he's kind of like on the edge, I guess. But other than that, there are 2 officers. One who has a Brady letter because in 2011, so this was a while ago, there was an investigation related to his actions around an internal police communication regarding the arrest of a friend, which was found to have violated several SPD rules and regulations. And then another against an officer who was found to be untruthful and who had falsified records and was out of his sector without permission on the day in question. So this is just an example of like the different things that can go into, and this is a serious oversimplification. These documents are available. A Somerville resident named Derek Rice, who made a public records request of the DA and got these documents in question. He has made them public. And if you email him, I think they're on Muckrack, but if you email him as well, he can give you copies of these if you are like wanting to see the precise documents. But we kind of go into a little bit more detail in the story. We also talked to the Somerville Police Chief David Fallon about this, how this impacts hiring, how this impacts case assignments. And he didn't really speak to this specifically, but he said, you know, that it's always kind of taken into account and that Brady letters are unique, but that it is, you know, always considered if an officer is up for promotion or, you know, things are taken, employment history is taken into consideration when assignments are being made. So it was a little bit more general. But this is just kind of something in terms of like kind of just keeping an eye on the police for people who are interested in kind of how things work. This is just one piece of things. It's something as a reporter who's covered like the confirmation of appointments process in Somerville, have seen before when it comes to police promotions and appointments. So if it's something you're curious about, I have a story up online. You're welcome to kind of look into it. I think it's a good intro, but it's something I'm going to keep paying attention to. And if you are more interested, please get in touch with me or get in touch with Derek or your ward counselor. And I'm sure that they can give you more information.
That's great information. Thanks, Julia. And we have to leave it there. We're
okay. Out of time.
But if anybody is interested in that story or anything else that we've talked about, and there's a lot of stuff that we meant to touch on that we're not going to have time for, go to somerville.wickedlocal.com and find out the latest happenings and concerns in Somerville. You can also visit us at somervillemedia.org just to take a look at some of the things that we've put together. We have regular city council updates, state delegation updates, and school committee updates. So I am Dave Ortega from Somerville Media Center. I want to thank once again Julia Taliesin from the Somerville Journal. Thanks,
thank
Julia.
Thank you. Thank you.